Good morning, Watershed, and good morning to our guests. My name's Billy. I'm one of the pastors here. It is a joy to be with you in worship this morning on this second Sunday of the season of Advent. And as I shared, as we talked about last week, this is a very important season in the life of the church, and it's really easy for us to view Advent as simply a four-Sunday countdown to Christmas. I know that's probably the way that all of our children see it. We light these four candles, and when we get to the end of them and light that Christ candle in the middle, it means it's Christmas. And so that certainly is a part of the season. But if we limit our understanding of the Advent season to that countdown to Christmas, we miss what I think is the main purpose and the main thrust of this Advent season. Definitely preparing ourselves for the birth of the Christ child is part of this season. But that birth of Christ, God breaking into our world so long ago during the season of Advent, is to serve for you and for me as a reminder. A reminder. One of the names that was given to Jesus, that was prophesied over Jesus, was the name Emmanuel. That song that we sing, O come, Emmanuel. And we typically hear that translated. Oh, that's an old Hebrew word. It simply means God with us. God is with us. It's one of those words that's really, it's a loaded term. It means more than we think it does. Emmanuel means God is with us today. He will be with us tomorrow. And he will continue to be with us forever. So Emmanuel is this really loaded term. It says once Emmanuel comes, not only is God with us in the person of Jesus, but because of Jesus, God is with us in a new way forever. So that's what we celebrate, and Advent reminds us that just as Christ came so long ago, he still comes today in the power of his Holy Spirit into our lives, breaking into our world, into the brokenness of the world around us. God is very much present and active in the power of his Holy Spirit. And more importantly, Advent reminds us that Jesus made a promise to us when he was here. He made a promise that he would come again, that he will return someday. And we look forward to that day because we believe that when that day comes, when Christ returns in his glory, he will bring the kingdom of God in all of its fullness with him. And all that is broken will be made whole again. All that is crooked will be made straight again. All that is wounded will be healed. There will be shalom throughout creation. And that shalom is not just peace. It means everything is the way God intends it to be. When Christ comes again, all will be as God desires it to be, as God intends it to be. And the Advent season reminds us of that promise and of that truth. And last week we talked about how through Clara, we're looking through the lens of the characters of the Nutcracker, and how Clara and all the other children were anxiously awaiting entry into that Christmas party, that we should, in the same way, anxiously await Jesus' return. Jesus is coming into the world in the power of the Holy Spirit, and Jesus returning in glory. We should anxiously await for that, and it shouldn't be a passive kind of waiting, but a very active waiting where we are about the business of preparing. Childbirth is the image that Scripture uses for it most, and many of you have been through that, and you know that preparing for the birth of a child is not a passive thing. It's a very busy and very active thing. There's a lot that you do to get ready for that child to come. And so that's the kind of waiting that we are called to do. And we're continuing using the Nutcracker as a lens through which we see and explore these different themes of the season of Advent. And I want to pause here and just say a word of thanks to Lowell, our director of youth discipleship, and to Shallon, our director of outreach, that Lowell found the plans and came up with the idea, and Shallon was the one who put the army of people together, who pulled off putting together these nutcrackers that we've got out in the entry area and up here in the worship space. And so it's a wonderful gift for us and to help us focus on this theme of the Nutcracker and these lessons that we learn. So last week we looked through the eyes of Clara. This week we're going to look through the eyes of a different character. We're going to look through the eyes of Drosselmeyer. Drosselmeyer is Clara's godfather. And there's a lot of things we know about Drosselmeyer. We know, most importantly, that he's the one who presents Clara with the gift of the Nutcracker. We know that when he shows up on the scene in the ballet, that he's this very mysterious figure, and people are kind of not really sure what to make of him and what to do with him. But when he reveals who he is, he often comes in cloaked and hooded, sometimes wearing a mask. And when he reveals who he is, everybody's excited, especially the kids are excited to see Drosselmeyer, because Drosselmeyer is a clockmaker and a toy maker, and he always brings the best gifts. And so the kids are excited to see him and can't wait to see what he has for them at the party. And you know that, of course, like we said, Drosselmeyer gives Clara the gift of the Nutcracker, and then later it is Drosselmeyer, his magic, that somehow brings the Nutcracker to life. And then that when the Nutcracker and the Mouse King fight, and both are mortally wounded in that fight, it is Drosselmeyer who steps back in and who resurrects the Nutcracker, brings him back to life. And then the Nutcracker takes Clara into his glorious kingdom and shows her all the wonders that he has in store for her. Does it sound a little bit familiar? It ought to sound familiar to those of us who follow Jesus. This is a very familiar storyline. What you may not know is that for Tchaikovsky, this was just kind of an offhand piece of work. When he was commissioned to do the orchestration for this ballet, it was a twofer deal. He was commissioned to do two pieces. It was the second piece that he was really interested in, and he just accepted writing the music for this Nutcracker ballet so that he could write the second piece of music. What they did is they took an old German folk tale and set it to music and wrote, choreographed this ballet for it. And of course, now it's what Tchaikovsky is best known for, is his work on the Nutcracker ballet. What you may not know is that when it was originally premiered in Russia, it was panned by all the critics. They couldn't stand it. They didn't like it. They didn't think the first act with the Christmas party and all the children and everything, and then the second act where they go off, where they fight the Mouse King, and then they go off into the land, to the kingdom of sweets and all these different things, that there was any way that those two things really connected. And in many ways, it's true. There's a very tenuous connection. And in a lot of productions of the Nutcracker, the one thing that connects them is often omitted. And it's something that Drosselmeyer does. Many of you, if you've seen production of the Nutcracker, you've probably seen Drosselmeyer's life-size toys that he brings out, and they're dancers, and they wind them up, and they dance for the kids, and the kids love it. Before he brings out those life-size toys in the original, he puts on a little show for the kids. He puts on a puppet show, and it's left out by a lot of productions because not everybody has marionettes and puppeteers and things like that. But when it's included, it's a very important and central part to the story, and it's what I want to look at this morning. And so to do this, we're going to look at this clip from Moscow Ballet's production of The Nutcracker. Now, you can see why leaving that out of the production might cause some confusion. It's really the only connection between Act 1 and Act 2, because there in that puppet show, you have the young girl who is attacked by the Mouse King, and then a soldier comes in and rescues her from it, which really becomes the crux of the second half of the show. In some productions, they try to kind of blend those two things together, and they'll take those life-size dolls, and instead of being a harlequin and a ballerina like it's written in the original, they'll do a tin soldier and the ballerina and the Mouse King, and they'll kind of stage that battle that way. And that's what really connects the first part of the show and the second part of the show. And that's what I really want to look at this morning as we are learning from Drosselmeyer, is that in many ways what he was doing in this production, he's kind of tipping his hat and giving Clara an idea of what lies ahead, of what she's going to experience. Because, of course, Clara becomes the young girl who is attacked by the Mouse King and all of his minions, and then the Nutcracker and the tin soldiers step up to defend them and to fight off the Mouse King and all of his minions and to save Clara. And so it's very much, Drosselmeyer is kind of giving Clara a heads up, letting her know, this foreshadowing. She's letting her know something that's coming that she needs to prepare for. He's being, in many ways, very prophetic. Very prophetic. And if you know anything about the Advent season and about the Christmas season, we know that the prophets play a very important role in this time of year. And there's a lot of amazing prophecies that prepared us for Jesus's first arrival, and that I think continue to prepare us for Jesus's second arrival. One of those that I want to look at and share with you this morning comes from the prophet Isaiah. In the 40th chapter, the prophet Isaiah writes this: "Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed, that her sin has been paid for, and that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill be made low." Every time I hear this passage of scripture, I have Handel's Messiah running in the back of my head. Every valley lifted, every hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain, and the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. So the prophet Isaiah spoke of a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. This message of this one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way, really is the very heart and soul of the Advent season. Why do we set aside these four Sundays to remind us of Jesus' promise to continue to come to us in the power of His Holy Spirit, to remind us of Jesus' promise to come again in glory with the fullness of His kingdom? We set aside these 4 days to remind us that we have a job to do until that comes. And that our job, our task, our assignment is to prepare the way for the Lord. We are called to prepare the way for Him. Now, the early Christians very clearly identified that voice crying in the wilderness. In the Gospel of Matthew, we read, "In those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea, saying, 'Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near.' This is he who was spoken of through the prophet Isaiah, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make straight paths for him.'" So the early Christians clearly understood that voice crying in the wilderness and preparing the way for the Lord was in fact John the Baptist. John preparing the way for Jesus' earthly ministry. He was the one in the wilderness. He was the one crying out. He was the one preparing the way of the Lord. And if you want just kind of a snippet and kind of a look at exactly how John went about preparing people for the way of the Lord, I look over in the Gospel of Luke and I read there, "John said to the crowds coming out to be baptized by him, 'You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath?'" So there you have it, the poster boy for the Advent season, John the Baptist. Happy Advent, you brood of vipers. How do we prepare the way of the Lord? We stand out in the wilderness and we cry out, "You're a bunch of snakes." Maybe not. Maybe not. That certainly was God's unique call on the life of John the Baptist, but I wonder if just maybe God is not calling you and me to prepare the way in a different way. Besides, I don't care too much for the camel skin and the locusts and wild honey anyway. So maybe we don't prepare the way by standing on the corner, shouting and yelling and telling people how bad they are. It's very clear. There are other people. There are others who follow Jesus who seem to think that is their task, to stand on the street corner and yell at people and tell them how horrible they are and how they better change, or they're going to regret it. But I wonder. You see, we live in a world where there are a lot of hills and valleys, a lot of rocky and rough places. And by that I mean we live in a world where believing that there is a God who loves me, who came in the person of Jesus to show that love, who laid down his life and rose again for me, where it's really hard to believe that. This world makes it hard to believe that there is a good God who loves me and wants good things for me. I think most people want to believe that. They really and truly do. They want to believe that there is a God, he is good, he loves me. But life keeps slamming them down. Life keeps throwing up hills and rocks and rough places. Life keeps telling them, no, no, no. And the most tragic thing of all, that sometimes those hills, those rocks, those rough places of life that make it difficult for people to believe that there is a God and that he is good and that he loves them come in the form of people who claim to be following said God. I think of the words of Catholic theologian Brennan Manning, who says the greatest single cause of atheism in the world today is Christians. Christians who acknowledge Jesus with their lips and then walk out the door and deny him by their lifestyle. Think about that for just a minute. In a world where life already makes it difficult to believe that there is a God and he is good and he loves us, there are people who claim to believe in that God who make it even harder to believe it. People who other folks look at and say, well, if that's what God's all about, I don't want anything to do with that. Thank you very much. John Pavlovich, theologian, said it this way. Sometimes the very best form of evangelism is simply to tell people that you're a Christian and then don't act like a jerk. You see, when I look at the Gospels, absolutely, you see John out in the wilderness crying, you bunch of snakes. When I look at the Gospels, I see Jesus saying to a woman caught in adultery, I don't condemn you either. I see Jesus eating with sinners and tax collectors. I see Jesus going up to young men who had been passed over by all the other rabbis and saying to them, come follow me. I see Jesus daring to touch the lepers. Now, whenever you start talking about the love and the grace and the mercy of Jesus and how he attracted people not through fear but through love, somebody is sure to stand up and say, yeah, but Jesus got mad too. Jesus turned over the tables in the temple after all. You know what? Yes. Jesus did get mad. You know who Jesus got mad at? The only people Jesus got mad at in the Gospels was religious leaders and civic leaders. People who were in positions of responsibility and power who took advantage of their position. People who claimed to represent God and who were giving God a bad name by the manner in which they represented him. That's who Jesus was mad at. Seems like maybe he's speaking potentially to people like you and me, much more so than, I never see Jesus getting angry with someone who's lost. You never see Jesus yelling at someone who doesn't have faith. You only see Jesus loving and being gracious and being kind to them. I submit to you that this is the way in which you and I are called to prepare the way of the Lord. This is what it means to raise up the deep valleys. Because folks have deep valleys in their life experience. Deep, deep lows where they have been beaten down so far that it's so hard to believe that there can be a good God. This is how you and I take those rough places and make them smooth. What does it mean to prepare the way of the Lord? It means very simply that you and I are called to do everything we can do to make it easy for people to believe in him, to make it easy for people to believe there is a God. He does love me. He is good. Several weeks ago, we celebrated All Saints Day. And we all called to our memory people who did that for us, right? We all remembered people who made it easy for us to believe that the love of God was real. People who embodied that love. And despite all the other stuff that the world threw at us, everything that convinced us it can't be real, because of that person, one or two people that we thought of on All Saints Day, we came to a place where we could say, yes, I believe. Folks, this is what it means to prepare the way of the Lord. This is what it means. This is what that season of Advent is all about. It is a reminder that as followers of Jesus Christ, we have been called to prepare the world to receive him, to make it as easy as possible for people to believe that this is real. You see, if you're one of those folks who has believed for a long time, or if you're one of those folks who really can't even think of a time in your life when you didn't believe, it may be hard for you to identify with and imagine what it's like to not believe. But trust me, there are people who don't believe have all kinds of reasons for not believing. And most often it's because of difficult things that they've been through. Most often it's because of the way that they've been treated by people who claimed to be acting on behalf of God, on behalf of Jesus. Preparing the way of the Lord is undoing that damage, is doing everything we can to help others believe. Wow, maybe this is real. How do you do it? The Bible's full of lots of great tips. Matthew 25, I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was sick. I was in prison. You came and you visited me. I was naked. You gave me clothes. I was homeless and you put a roof over my head. Micah chapter 6. He has shown you, mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? Do justice. Do what's right. Love mercy. Be merciful when others have wronged you. And walk humbly with God. The greatest commandment, Jesus said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. This is the first and the greatest commandment. And the second's like it. You shall love your neighbor as you love yourself. On these two things hang all the law and all the prophets. Do these, and you will live. How do we prepare the way for the Lord? We prepare the way for Him in our own lives? Certainly. By loving God. By doing those things that we know nurture the love of God in us. By worshiping together like this. By being part of a deeper group or another small group where we're sharing the love of God with one another. By praying. By reading and studying the Bible. These things that we know nurture the love of God in us. And then we prepare the way in others' lives by loving them. By loving our neighbors. They have a need that you can meet, do so. In your interactions with others, be kind, be gracious, be loving, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, just like God. I think that for a lot of people who have roadblocks in their lives and stumbling blocks that have been put in their way that make it difficult for them to believe, sometimes all they need to see is a genuine follower of Jesus being kind and loving to them and working to get those roadblocks out of the way. Now, understand this. Had an evangelism professor in seminary who really wanted to make sure we knew and understood this. He said, listen, you do not love people in order to evangelize them. That's called manipulation. But you don't love people as a gimmick to try to get them to come to faith. That's manipulation. Don't do that, he said. What you want to do is, because you love them, you evangelize them. Because you love people, you want them to know the love of God. Because you love people, you want to make it easy for them to accept Jesus. Because you love them, you want to make them know that this stuff really is real. So once you've done all of this to prepare the way, I want to encourage you to do one last thing. Never forget this. I've heard the story many times of there was a young Franciscan monk who was actually within the same community as St. Francis, was very eager to learn from Francis, had a heart for evangelism, for telling other people about Jesus, for leading other people to faith. And so he was excited one day when St. Francis said, come on, let's go into the village and let's do some evangelism. And so he spent the whole day with St. Francis, and they went throughout the village, and they talked with people, and they helped people that needed help with a task, and they stopped and spent time with everybody, and they just loved on people and were just generally good to people. And then at the end of the day, as they were walking back to the monastery, the young monk said to Francis, I don't understand, Brother Francis. I thought we were going to evangelize people today. And he said, we did. There's where Francis was supposedly to have said, you know, tell the gospel. Say the gospel always. When necessary, use words. So we need our actions to speak the love of Jesus. But I want you to understand this, folks. It is necessary to use words. It is necessary to use words. It is necessary when you're being kind and gracious and someone says, wow, why are you doing this? Because God loves you and so do I. Because Jesus is real. Tell people that Jesus is the reason you love them. Jesus is the one who fills you with love and enables you to love them. There's a lot of work to do. There's a lot of rocky ground out there. There's a lot of deep valleys out there. Advent reminds us that like John the Baptist prepared the way for the ministry of Jesus, you and I are called to prepare the way for others to encounter Jesus in the power of his Holy Spirit. And you and I are called to prepare the way for the day when Jesus ultimately comes in his glory. We've got work to do. Let's get going. Amen.